yesterday about and we need to be students of the Bible. Some of you were surprised when you were shown about the way the hymnal, our SDA hymnal, was sung. And it's important that our only safety is in the Word of God. If we don't study our Bibles, we are going to receive error, and we shall be lost. And we shall only have ourselves. So I wanted to show you something about this one, should be one or two slides about the lesson was teaching, was denying creation. So if you can allow me, I'll just take you two or three slides back, so that we can see together before I continue with my country living thing.
Okay, I hope you're getting me now. This was the lesson of 2013 January, talking about origins. It was entitled Origins. This is the very first lesson on Sunday. And it shows there, without form and void, the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, darkness on the face of the deep. The Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the water, the UK King James Version. I'd like us to look at the second paragraph. The Bible starts with the story of creation, and the creation story starts with a statement that God is the creator. It describes the condition of the world when God began to prepare it for occupancy. When the story begins, the planet is already here, but unformed and filled, dark and wet. What does that mean? When God began creating, the planet is already here. What does that mean? It means that God did not create the earth. It was already there. Then it says, the succeeding verses describe how God first formed the world into an inhabitable place and then filled it with living creatures. The text does not tell us exactly when the rocks and the water of the earth came into existence. Only that the world had not always been suitable for life. This is your Sabbath school lesson quarterly. I never had any protest, any complaint from anywhere. 2013, it's entitled Origins. I'm sure you must be having it in your home, if you used to have the lesson. And so I'm telling you, it's important that we are students of the Bible. Do not take something because it's coming from the higher up and assume that it is the Word of God. Then the next paragraph, it says, when the earth was first brought into existence, it was unsuitable for life. The Bible says nothing about the time period between the original creation of the rocks and water and the creation of the environment and the creatures. Some scholars think it might have been immediately, others that it might have been after a long time. The simple fact is we don't know. Nor does it really matter. Why do we have to keep the Sabbath then if it doesn't matter? Whatever the case, the material of the earth was created by God, and then at the time of his choosing, he created a suitable environment for life. The crucial point is that the Lord, who was not dependent upon pre-existing matter, used matter that he at some point already created. Something that in its primeval state was told. Now they use those hard words. And afterwards, through the power of his word, he created another world. So we need to be students of the Bible. We need to have truth and faith. Alright? Without faith, we cannot please God. Yeah. Alright? Now, let's look at 1 week later, the following week. talking about the earth completed. The title of the lesson the following week is The Earth Completed. Again, Sunday, sun, moon, and stars. The fourth day has probably been discussed more than any of the other six creation days. If the sun was created on the fourth day, what caused the daily cycles for the first three creation days? On the other hand, if the sun already existed, what happens on the fourth day? Uncertainty over the events. Can you guys read behind that? Uncertainty over the events of the fourth day of creation does not arise from a logical contradiction, but from a plurality of possibilities. This is Babylonian thinking. Possibilities, theorems, you know, theories. Okay? One possibility is that the sun was created on the fourth day, and the light for the first 3 days came from God's presence, or from another source, such as a supernova. Revelation 21:23 is consistent with this idea, as the sun is not needed in the heavenly city, because God is there. A second possibility is that the sun, moon, and stars were appointed their function at that time. A Hebrew scholar, C. John Collins, writes that the Hebrew wording may allow either of these possibilities. A third possibility is that the sun was already in existence, but obscured by clouds or volcanic dust, and was not visible or fully functional until the... This is your lesson. This is from... what is the name of that guy? Goldstein? Clifford Goldstein? Is the edit... Is the what? Is the one in charge of the lesson quarterly. This is what they approved. The text does not seem clearly to endorse or rule out any of... No. One can compare... Well, yeah. Does not rule out any of these interpretations, although this does not deter strong opinions on the topic. It is probably a good rule not to give a question more significance than the Bible gives it, and we ought to acknowledge that our understanding is limited. This acknowledgement, especially in the area of creation, should be that hard to accept. After all, think about how scientific mysteries exist at present time. How many scientific mysteries exist at present time? That is, they are right here for experimental science to investigate. That is your lesson. So I thought maybe something I should mention to you, but it's good that when you look at some of these church writings or church publications, we need to be very careful. The enemy is within. It's not from without. And so, cling to your Bibles. Thus says the Lord. But to the law and to the testimony. If they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no life in them. Alright. We can get going to our lesson today. So, how do we go to the country? How? Yesterday we... What were we studying yesterday? What was our topic yesterday for country living? I'm sure you're settled down from the shock. There is more than you can be shocked with. So you just need to know that you are on your own. You are on... This is where I used to help my youth in Central Church. I used to be the youth sponsor there. And as I was about to leave, I told them, young people, you are on your own. Do not depend on the church. You are on your own. Get your Bible, get down on the knees, study the word of God for yourself, and save your own soul. Don't wait for your grandfather, your elder, or you have to study for yourself. What did we study yesterday? How far is far? How far from the city? Where do we go? So, on the first day, we studied why. Why should we get out of the city? And we saw there, for those who came today, the secondary reason that we leave the city is what? The second reason that we should be leaving the cities is what? To escape God's judgment, God's impending judgment. The primary reason and most important reason why we should leave the city is what? It's for character perfection. Perfection of character. character. And we saw that not one family in 100 will perfect character in the city. If you cannot perfect character in the city, you have no chance to get to heaven. If you cannot perfect character, you cannot stand a chance to go to heaven. And God has shown us that the best place to perfect character is out in the country. So let us break every tie, let us cut every family tie, everything that hinders from a full committal of ourselves in the service of God. And that can only happen in the country. So let's get to the country as soon as possible. How? How do we get to the country? This is the question that has been in the minds of a number of you. How do I get to the country? I am here in the city. I live with my parents. I am renting a house. I'm working somewhere. How do we get to the country? And I think that Zadok touched on my presentation a little bit. So I am now repeating a little bit more on what he did, how we are going to get into the country. Except the Lord build a house, they labor in vain that build it. Except the Lord keep the city, the watchman waketh in vain. It is better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in man. It is better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in princes. Thus saith the Lord, cursed be the man that trusted in man, and whose heart departed from the Lord. Blessed is the man that trusted in the Lord, and whose hope the Lord is. Okay? So, like a recap of where we lived the past day, why do we need to leave the cities? To do what? To develop the character of Jesus. That is the primary reason. We need to be in nature, where God is fully there, so that we can establish God's image in our souls. And the prime secondary reason, to escape God's judgment. And then, the second night, where do we go? We need to move as far away from the big cities as possible. Where we can have elbow room, where we can avoid interference from potential enemies, where we are not influenced by our neighbors, where they are not too close together with us, and where we can establish little colonies or locations where other Adventists are also living. Okay, so how do we leave the city? Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen, for by it the elders obtained a good report. Through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. Faith, we need to have faith in God in order for us to leave the city. The other day, I think it was the first day I was telling you, when you hear people saying that Abraham believed in God and it was counted for him righteousness. And ask me, what does that statement mean? It was not an intellectual accent. Oh God, what you're saying is true. I believe it. No. Believing in God meant that Abraham took some steps of faith as a result of his believing God. Faith without works is what? It's dead. People can only know that you have faith in something when they see it in action, when you're doing it in action. Alright? So, without faith, we cannot please God. By faith, Abel offered unto God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain. So you can see, people are known of their faith by what they did. Abel offered a more excellent sacrifice. By faith, Enoch was translated that he should not see death, and was not found because God had translated him. For before his translation, he had this testimony that he did what? He pleased God. So that is how we get that definition, that without faith it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently. Okay, so we need faith in order for us to get to the country. How do we get to the country? By faith. You don't go to the country by sight, where you have got 2 million shillings in the pocket, say, now I think I'm going to the country. Because then you will go there by your own strength. We need to go to the country the way the Israelites left Egypt.
Amen.
They did carry mitungis of water, and in a short while the water ran out, but they went by faith anyway. They grumbled on the way, but they went anyway. You know, many times we fought the Israelites, but those people had a lot of faith. They did not sit down to reason with Moses. Now, we are going to the wilderness. Where is food going to come from? They didn't reason that. They went by faith. Do you want to own a country home? The substance is the house you hope for. We need to know how to exercise faith. There are those who find it hard to exercise faith, and they place themselves on the doubting side. Though these lose much because of their unbelief. Okay? Miracles. Let's look at some miracles. The parting of the Red Sea. How did that happen? Exodus 15 verse 1, then sang Moses and the children of Israel this song unto the Lord and spake, saying, I will sing unto the Lord, for he had triumphed gloriously. This time they had come out of the sea, and the Egyptians had come in, and Moses put his rod onto the water, and the waters came back, and they completely drowned their enemies. I will sing unto the Lord, for he had triumphed gloriously. The horse and his rider had he drawn into the sea, and with the blast of thy nostrils the waters were gathered together. The flood stood upright as an heap, and the depths were congealed. Congealed means something that is become solidified, so that they walked as it were on a dry ground, not on a muddy ground. Alright? That word congealed, you should take note of that. Alright? Then spake Joshua. Now, before that, I just want to mention something here. The Israelites were not given advance information on what God is going to do. When they stood before the Red Sea and they saw the column of dust of Egyptian soldiers coming after them, God did not give them a hint on how he was going to deliver them. On their right side were mountains, on their left were mountains, in front of them was the Red Sea. God did not tell them that, you know, when you get there, I'm going to part the ocean. Even Moses did not know. But they stood there because God had told them, take this direction. And if they had used reason, like Eve, they would tell them, how do we go this direction? We went towards the ocean. We don't have a boat. Either we have a ferry. But they walked anyway. Sometimes God asks us to do foolish things. Like Naaman. And all he wants is our obedience. I don't believe the Jordan River had a natural remedy for leprosy. No. But because Naaman obeyed, God healed him. And because the Israelites obeyed and walked towards the sea, and did something in the eyes of human beings was a foolish thing, God used that foolishness to make the Egyptians foolish. And he parted the Red Sea and they walked right on. So when you read this, there are a lot of things that we actually have left out. The faith they had to walk towards something that doesn't add up. And so when our friend was telling us yesterday that he packed his things and started driving towards our house he has not seen, it required faith for Nathaniel to go to a place he has not seen. But God provided a way for him. And for Joshua, then spake Joshua to the Lord in the day when the Lord delivered up the Amorites before the children of Israel, and he said in the sight of Israel. I think let's read this story a little bit. Joshua chapter 10. You know, I came to realize that maybe we have not all shared, read this story. Joshua, the book of Joshua. I was telling you about it in the morning. You know, you guys have been in Babylonian schools and you've been told that the earth goes around the sun and revolves once every 24 hours. They greater foolishness than that. Joshua chapter 10.
Yes.
Now it came to pass when Adonizedek, king of Jerusalem, had heard how Joshua had taken Ai and had utterly destroyed it as he had done to Jericho, her king, so he had done to Ai and her king, and how the inhabitants of Gibeon had made peace with Israel and were among them, that they feared greatly, because Gibeon was a great city, as one of the royal cities. And because it was greater than I and all the men that were of it. Therefore, Adonizedek, king of Jerusalem, said that Hoham, king of Hebron, and Piram, king of Jarmuth, and unto Japhia, king of Lachish, and unto Deborah, king of Eglon, saying, come up unto me and help me that we may smite Gibeon. For it had made peace with Joshua and the children of Israel. Therefore the five kings of the Amorites, the king of Jerusalem, the king of Hebron, and king of Jarmuth, and king of Lachish, and king of Eglon, gathered themselves together and went up, and they and all their hosts encamped before Gibeon and made war against it. And of course the men of Gibeon, because they had just made an agreement with Joshua, they went and asked Joshua for help to come and fight these five kings. So Joshua, verse 7, descended from Gilgal, and he and all the people of war with him, and all the mighty men of Bela, and the Lord said unto Joshua, fear them not, for I have delivered them into thine hand. There shall not a man of them stand before thee. Joshua therefore came unto them suddenly, and went up from Gilgal all night, and the Lord discomfited them before Israel, and slew them with a great slaughter at Gibeon, and chased them along the way that goeth up to Beth Horon, and smote them to Azekah and unto Mekah. And it came to pass as they fled from before Israel and were in the going down of Beth Horon, that the Lord cast down great stones from heaven upon them and to Azekah, and they died, and they were more which died in hailstones than they whom the children of Israel slew with the sword. Then spake Joshua to the Lord in the day when the Lord delivered up the Amorites before the children of Israel. And he said in the sight of Israel, son, stand thou still upon Gibeon, and thou moon in the valley of Ajalon. And the sun stood still, and the moon stayed until the people had avenged themselves upon their enemies. Is not this written in the book of Joshua? So the sun stood still in the midst of heaven, and hasted not to go down about a whole day. What does the Bible say about the sun and the earth? Is it the earth that rotates on its own, or is it the sun that rotates around the earth? What does the word of God say?
The sun.
It is the sun that rises from the east, and sets where? But what are you told in Babylon? The sun is the center and the earth spins. So that you see the sun rising, but it is the earth that is doing what? And so this great miracle, if you go by what you are taught in school, you will never appreciate what God did. That the sun stood still and did not move for about a day. And both the sun and the moon. And you know, for Joshua to have prayed for something like that, you know, it's unthinkable. It's unthinkable to ask God, God, I want the sun to stand still. Because there are many people who are depending on the sun, isn't it? I mean, you're not alone in this world. But then, you know, you make a request to God, and God listens to your voice and causes everybody else to wait until you finish your work.
Amen. Praise God.
And so the sun stood still and did not hasten. And verse 14, he says, and there was no day like that before it or after it, that the Lord hearkened unto the voice of a man to stop the movement of the heavenly bodies by just the request of a man. Our God is a loving God. If you have an emergency, he can ask the rain to meet.
Amen.
He can ask the sun to stand still. That's why Jesus Christ said, if you have faith, you can tell that mountain to remove from there and go to the bottom of the sea. Faith. We are talking about how you are going to the countryside. Here is a man who asked the sun to stand still. I mean, which one is easier? Is you finding land in the country or asking the sun to stand still? Now, and that is why he was not the only one. And you know the Bible? By the testimony of two witnesses. I'm telling you that the sun is the one that rises from the east to the west. Let's see. In those days was Hezekiah sick unto death. And Isaiah the prophet, the son of Amos, came unto him and said unto him, thus says the Lord, set thine house in order, for thou shalt die and not live. And this shall be a sign unto thee from the Lord, that the Lord will do this thing that he has spoken. Wait a minute, I jumped something. Let's look at the story. Isaiah 38. Isaiah 38. You know, you guys, you have been so messed up with the modern education that we have to undo and unlearn all that we were cheated by our teachers in those Spanish schools. And we paid for it. In those days was Hezekiah sick unto death, and Isaiah the prophet, the son of Amos, came unto him and said unto him, thus saith the Lord, set thine house in order, for thou shalt die. And of course, as usual, Hezekiah cried, holy good God, all these things I've done. Then verse 4, then there came the word of the Lord to Isaiah, saying, go and say to Hezekiah, thus saith the Lord, the God of David thy father, I have heard thy prayer, I have seen thy tears. Behold, I will add unto thy days 15 years, and I will deliver thee of this city out of the hand of the king of Assyria, and I will defend this city. And this shall be a sign unto thee from the Lord, that the Lord will do this thing that he hath spoken. Behold, I will bring again the shadow of the degrees which is gone down in the sundial of ours, 10 degrees backward. Well, it was very unusual that he brings the shadow 10 degrees backward. So the sun returned. Hello?
Yeah.
What is it that returned? The earth.
The sun.
The sun returned 10 degrees by which degrees it was gone down. And I can tell you that the Babylonians that time, those people who used to study astronomy, noticed that phenomenon. I said, oh! And you know, for them, the sun was one of their gods. What has happened? Then they were told, you know, there is a guy in Israel who prays to his God and he returned the sun back. And you know, Hezekiah had the best opportunity to witness about the God of heaven. But when they came, the people from Babylon, what did Hezekiah do? When God has given you a country home and the people come from Babylon, what will you do? Will you witness about the God of heaven, or will you show them all your wealth? So the sun returned 10 degrees by which it has gone down. It was gone down. Alright? The simplicity of the gospel. We are in continual danger of getting above the simplicity of the gospel. There is an intense desire on the part of many to startle the world with something original that shall lift the people into a state of spiritual ecstasy and change the present order of experience. There is certainly great need of a change in the present order of experience, for the sacredness of present truth is not realized as it should be. But the change we need is a change of what? Is a change of heart. True education, country living, the issue is a change of our thinking. The heart in the Bible is actually your mind. It's not the one that is beating book, book, book. When you read that, a change of heart, it is a change in our thinking. We need God to give us a new heart so that we can start thinking from His point of view. Selected messages. I love to check whether it's volume 1 or volume 2 or 27. These things have I written unto you that ye believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life, that ye may believe on the name of the Son of God, And this is the confidence that we have in Him, that if we ask anything according to His will, He hears. And if we know that He hears us, whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we desire of Him. I learned something yesterday, that we actually waste a lot of time delaying, hesitating, when we are supposed to act in faith. That quotation that our friend read for us from Gospel Workers, that sometimes the angels of God are just tired waiting for us to make the move. You've asked for something, God is ready to give it to you, and you're not sure, will He actually do it? Will He do it? Because we doubt. Verily, verily, I say to you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do, shall he do also. And greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. Ask, and it shall be given you. Seek, and ye shall find. Knock, and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh, receiveth. And he that seeketh, findeth. And to him that knocketh, it shall be opened. Going to the country is not a science. It is faith and truth. You have to learn to depend on God. You need to humble yourself and ask God to guide you. And God will open the way. Because He has said it, you don't have to worry. If God has said it, it is His problem. Where are you going to get a place? That is God's problem. It's not yours. Just do what He has said. Go in humility. The prayer of faith will be answered. There are conditions. You lust and have not. You kill and desire to have and cannot obtain. You fight and war, yet ye have not, because ye ask not. Ye ask and receive not, because ye ask amiss. We ask wrongly. Okay? That ye may consume it upon your lusts. When we go into the country, whatever we have, whatever God is going to give us, is not for our own selfish use. It is for His service. And if you're going to ask God to help you to go in the country, to be a missionary, to serve other people, then He is going to answer it. But if you're going to ask God with a Babylonian mindset, God, I want to have a good, nice country home where I can relax and just be drinking my juice as I while away the time, you know, you're not going to get it. Because you're asking. If I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. Oftentimes we are asking while we are clinging to petty sins. While we are clinging to some wrong habits. While you say, me, this one I cannot eat. How will God hear you when you are holding an enemy within? He that turneth away is here from hearing the law, even his prayer shall be an abomination. So when we ignore God's laws, when we blatantly, knowingly break His laws, even our prayer will be an abomination. You know, when we were praying for that lady who was possessed, I have never prayed like that for myself. I had to search myself, because I had been told that there were some other people who were praying for a demon-possessed person, and there were some elders there, and they had been warned, you know, if you have a problem in your life, don't come. And these elders just said, your elders, they went. And they reached there, and they were given a beating. They were beaten, their shoes were torn. So when I had this story that I was needing that, I was actually praying for myself. Thank God, if I have something wrong with this, please forgive me. Because here, this is no jokes. So when we are going to seek for help from God, please let us consecrate ourselves. Let us confess for us. Like the Day of Atonement, the Israelites afflicted their souls on that day. Make sure there was any unconfessed sin that God can forgive you for.
somebody read for us?
The Bible reads.
Proverbs 15, verse 29. Are we there?
The Lord is far from the wicked, but he hears the prayer of the righteous.
The Lord is far from the wicked, but he hears the prayer of the righteous. When we come to God in prayer and he forgives our sins, then he will hear our prayer. Okay? And Psalms 34 verse 17. Psalms 34 verse 17.
The righteous cry, and the Lord heareth, and delivereth them out of all their troubles.
Out of some of their troubles?
All.
Out of all their troubles. When you go to the country without trouble, things may not work out. But when you cry unto the Lord, he will hear it. And God takes us through trials. He takes us through challenges so that he can develop our faith in him. Okay? And 1 John chapter 3 verse 22. 1 John chapter 3 verse 22. What does it say?
It says, and whatsoever we ask, we receive of him, because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight.
Yes, we receive of him because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight. Without faith, we cannot please. So if you want to please God, we need to have faith in him. Okay? How we go to the country? We have to go by faith. We have to believe that if God has told us to go, he will make the way for us. And we need to start praying for those things that we need to go to the country. We need to pray that we can be led by God in everything that we do. Okay. Second volume, 2T. Testimonies for the Church, Volume 2, page 146. I will read for you, because I can see all of us have this. Fasting and prayer will accomplish nothing while the heart is estranged from God by a long course of action. Okay? Can you see where we are heading? Fasting and prayer will accomplish nothing while the heart is estranged from God by a long course of action. If God has clearly told us this is the way we are supposed to go, if there are some commandments, some requirements, be it some health reform, be it some reform in whatever that he has given us, and we insist on that course of action, then however much we are fasting, avail nothing. I saw that the reason why God did not hear the prayers of his servants for the sick among us, more fully was that he could not be glorified in so doing while they were violating the laws of health. I've actually heard of cases where a medical missionary has gone and treated somebody of cancer. And the person was completely treated. And the medical missionary did exactly the way she was supposed to do it. She told the patient that, you need to change your eating habits, you need to change your lifestyle, it is God who brings the healing, and all that stuff. And they were healed. And as soon as they were given a clean bill of health, the patient went back to eating meat. And the cancer has come back. That is why sometimes God doesn't bother to cancel some of those prayers. Because he knows that as soon as you are healed, you will go back. There are those people out there who are seeing like it's a punishment to deny them their appetite, their needs. And they will endure the deprivation of that food that they love for the sake of getting rid of the pain. But as soon as the pain is taken away, they will be the first ones to go back. So that was not genuine repentance. They didn't really believe
And so let us know that many commissioners expect that, you know, when somebody is healed, they appreciate. No, the human heart can be very difficult. It can be very difficult. And I also saw that he designed the health reform and health institute to prepare the way for the prayer of faith to be fully answered. We should first find out if the sick one has been withholding tithes or has made trouble in the church. Before you go to pray for them, you know, are we withholding our tithes? Our tithes are supposed to support God's workers, you know. And so we should be supporting them with our first fruits. Do not forget, especially when you go to the country and you start having a bountiful harvest, do not forget to support the work of God. Alright? So, another praying principle, pray it before the Lord. Right? I love the way, where is my friend Nathan? He was supposed to give his second part of testimony today. I hope he's around. When he learned about the need to leave the city, they brought the book, Country Living, and spread it before the Lord. And prayed, God, help us to follow this instruction. And they immediately started making arrangements to leave. So when you have a problem, you write it down and spread it before the Lord. That is a principle that we should take. And Hezekiah received the letter of the hand of the messengers and read it. And Hezekiah went up to the house of the Lord and spread it before the Lord. He got a letter from the enemy. I think it was the Assyrians. They had surrounded the city and they had written a letter that he should surrender. And he spread it before the Lord. Okay? And the Lord answered his prayer. The prayer of Moses was heard and answered, and we also may present our honest petitions to God and receive of his grace and power. Tell the Lord exactly what you want in the way of spiritual blessing, and you need not fear today before your temporal needs and perplexity. And I'd like us to look at this story. How did God answer this prayer? 2 Kings chapter 19. Let's see, read from the word of God. How did God answer the prayer of Hezekiah when he spread it before the Lord? What is it that he spread before the Lord? Chapter 19. And if we start from verse 1.
It says, from verse 1, chapter 19, it says, and it came to pass. So,
I think, just hold on.
From verse 12.
14.
Let's start from. Verse 9.
Verse 9, it says, and when he had say of Tirhaka, king of Ethiopia, behold, he is come out to fight against thee. He sent his messengers again unto Hezekiah, saying, thus shall he speak to Hezekiah, king of Judah, saying, let not thy God in whom thou trustest deceive thee, saying, Jerusalem shall not be delivered into the hand of the king of Assyria. Behold, thou hast heard what the kings of Assyria have done to all lands, by destroying them utterly. And shalt thou be delivered? Have the gods of the nations delivered them which my fathers have destroyed, as Gozan, and Haran, and Rezeph, and the children of Eden, which were in the Lassa? Where is the king of Hamad, and the king of Arpad, and the king of the city of Sepharvaim, of Hena and Eva?
So this is Rabashek, and he has sent this message to Hezekiah. So verse 14.
It says, and Hezekiah received the letter of the hand of the messengers and read it. And Hezekiah went up into the house of the Lord and spread it before the Lord.
So that is what Hezekiah, that is what was happening, and then Hezekiah spread it before the Lord. And what did the Lord answer?
It says, from verse?
From verse 20.
20. Then Isaiah the son of Amos sent unto Hezekiah, saying, thus saith the Lord God of Israel, that which thou hast prayed to me against Sennacherib, king of Assyria, I have heard.
Aha! Did you hear that? God has the prayer of Hezekiah. He's spread it before the Lord, and the Lord sent word that you have, that which you have asked of me about the king of Assyria, I have heard. And he proceeds to explain to him what he's going to do. And so when we have this problem, let us pray it before the Lord. And let us pray over it. And God is able to deliver us from those troubles. The prayer of Moses was heard and answered, and we also may present our honest petitions to God and receive of his grace. Okay? If you've seen that, tell the Lord exactly what you want. Many times we ask God and we are very ambiguous. Oh Lord, please help us and meet our needs, daily needs. And that time you know you have a small problem, you have a specific problem, but you are covering it in a general sense, hoping that God will figure it out. No, God wants us to be specific. You know, it's just like the way we like to praise God in a way that you can never even praise man, with foolish songs. Songs that are songs of drunkards and songs of the of madmen. Songs that don't make sense. And we think that the creator of heaven will be pleased by such songs. The song of fools. The song of the harlot. Do you guys know what I'm talking about? Here I am to worship. Here I am to nada. Here I am. It's the song of the drunkard. Why are you asking? What are you telling me about? God is intelligent. Let us be specific in our praise. For singing is as much an act of worship as prayer. And so when we are talking to God, remember you are talking to the Creator. I mean, if you come to me and start being a little there, you know, Sammy, I just wanted you to help. You know, I have some problems. Just help. Help. So what are you talking about? How do you want me to help you? You cannot be specific. So when we are going to God in prayer, let us be specific. Let us tell God, I have this, I need 3,000 shillings so that I can get myself to this place, or I can purchase this. And this is the problem I have. Lord, please help me get this. Or I have this boil on my leg and it has refused to heal. Please help me to find a remedy to heal this. Let us be specific to God. Let us not have generalities. And then we wonder why God is not answering our prayer. You know, because people who are ambiguous are people who don't believe that God actually exists. When you're ambiguous to God, you actually don't think he exists. Because if you do, you will speak to him like you will speak to your parents. Children are never ambiguous. Children are very specific. When they come and say, Mommy, can I have this? They are very specific. That is why Jesus said, unless your faith is like that of a child, you will never what? You never enter the kingdom of heaven. Alright. Learn to pray short and right to the point. Stop having long prayers. You think that God will hear them because they are so long. Let us have short, precise prayers, okay? To the point, asking for just what you need. Sufficient for the day. Sufficient for the day. You guys are not Bible students. Sufficient for the day. Is the evil thereof. Stop worrying about tomorrow. What am I going to eat and clothe and what? No, Jesus told us. There is enough problems for today. Let's deal with them now. So ask just what you need. Remember the Israelites in the desert. They received manna just for today. They didn't receive manna for the day after tomorrow. Okay? So let us ask just what you need. Let us learn to pray intelligently, expressing our requests with clearness and precision. Let us pray as though it means the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. How do we get to the country? Let us have specific prayers. Let us have prayers that we know God will hear. If he had Hezekiah, and it's not like Hezekiah was righteous. You know what he did, but God had him. He had Joshua. These were people who were flesh and blood and cast. They were of like passion. God had the prayer of Joshua and the sun stood still. Even Moses never prayed for that. And yet Moses is in heaven. Joshua was just a man like you and me. I said, we have to win this war. God, please let that sun stand still. And if God had it, let us have prayers of faith. And you will be surprised what God can do. Get together in companies of two or three and go off into some quiet place to seek the Lord. When you're going to the country, get together in companies of two, not go alone. Get in companies of at least two or three, then you can be able to pray and seek the Lord. His promise is that where two or three are agreed together as touching anything, their prayer will be answered. So even when you have this issue, get together and pray about it. And God will hear prayer. Get together in companies of two or three, go off into some quiet place. Number three, seek the Lord. Okay? And then number four, their prayer will be answered. Somewhere. Okay? Many, even in their seasons of devotion, fail of receiving the blessings of real communion with God. They are in too great a haste. Sometimes we pray to God and we can't even finish and we are out. Say, you know, God, I'll see you later. I'm late now. And so even before God will sit to understand what you are saying, you are already out. And you walk away with your body. Because we don't believe in God. With hurried steps, they press through the circle of Christ's loving presence, pausing perhaps a moment within the sacred places, but not waiting for counsel. They have no time to remain with the divine teacher. With their burdens, they return to their work. They don't have time for counsel. Prayer is not to change God's mind. It is prayer is to make us come up to God. We don't pray so that God can come down, like the way they sing out there in the evangelicals, let your glory fall. No. Prayer is to bring us up to the presence of God. Okay? And so when you are in prayer, you receive counsel from God. But if you are in a hurry, then God will, you will just walk away with your problem. God can't force you. Okay? Those who are unwilling to deny self, to agonize before God, to pray long and honestly for his blessing, will not obtain it. Remember we heard, how many times did Elijah pray? Somebody gave us a story about Elijah, isn't it? And he said that he would have continued praying. If by the seventh time the rain had not come, he would have continued praying. That is agonizing until God answers the prayer. Okay? Wrestling with God, how few know what it is. How few have ever had their soul drawn out after God. With intensity of desire, until every power is on the street. Many of us, we pray about something, and we don't see it, and we give us. I think God has said no. We don't wrestle with God. We give up too soon. You pray, if the answer is not immediate, I told you, this thing that I want. God didn't say that you pray once. Each one has got different conditions of their heart. And God will deal with each one of us differently. And so let us wrestle with God until he gives us an answer. Okay? If you find voice and time to pray, God will find time and voice. Find voice and time to pray. God, you time, find time and voice. Okay. By faith, who? Moses.
Moses.
He forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. God, Moses endured. He knew that this, the God of his father, the God that his mother taught him about, was real. And that is why he could walk away from Egypt, because he endured as seeing him who is invisible. So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the
word
of God. Okay? So, this is how some of us want to go to heaven. We want to go to heaven, to the place to heaven, but we think we are bound for the kingdom, when actually we are bound where?
To this world.
To this world. You have tied a rope to a pole here, and you think you want to go to the heavenly kingdom. What is tying you? Pleasure and treasure of this world. So we say we are marching to Zion, but we are actually firmly rooted in this world. Go to now, ye rich men, weep and howl for your misery that shall come upon you. Your riches are corrupted, and your garments are moth eaten. Your gold and silver is canker, and the rust of them shall be a witness against you, and shall eat your flesh as it were fire. Ye have heaped treasure together for the last day. There will be a time when that those who have money and wealth will not use. They won't be needed. There's a time that God needs your talents, and it is now. There will come a time when you read this very sad statement. God does not need your energy anymore. He doesn't need your talent. He doesn't need your money anymore. The time he needed them, you didn't need them. And so you will see that he will tell you he doesn't need them. You have kept that treasure for the last days. I was directed to James 5, verse 1 to 3. I saw that these fearful ones apply particularly to the wealthy who profess to believe the present truth. Hello? Who profess to believe the present truth. The Lord calls them to use their means to advance his cause. Opportunities are presented to them, but they shut their eyes to the wants of the cause and cling fast to their earthly treasure. Their love for the world is greater than their love for the truth. Their love for their fellow men or their love for God. So when Zadok says we have a problem here, there's a deficit for this conference, please, brother so-and-so, can you help us with some money? I don't have any money. And that time you have money. And so Zadok goes around, you know, I know the Swahili word, anangaika. When you could have used your wealth for the cause. People who believe in present truth, but they don't want to use their means to support the cause. He calls for their substance, but they selfishly, covetously retain what they have. They give a little now and then to ease their conscience, but have not overcome their love for this world. They do not sacrifice for God. The Lord has raised up others that prize eternal life, and that can feel and realize something of the value of the soul. And they have freely bestowed their means to advance the cause of God. The work is closing, and soon the means of those who have kept their riches, their large farms, their cattle, ADC, you may cling to your job, you may cling to the wealth that you have. And I was telling somebody earlier on, I said there, that when you go to the country, and you start doing this farming thing, and you make the money, it is not the same like in Babylon. The money you are making is for the cause of God. It is not for your own luxury and comfort. It's a different game. It's a different mindset. You are not amassing wealth. You are getting resources that can enable the work to advance so that you can support another conference like this. You can provide food for the next conference. You can provide money to print Bibles. The greatest challenge I have found in mission work is not to give great control. Is not to give the kind of books I saw here. They are not needed. When you go out there in mission, there is one thing that is needed. Bibles. Let me tell you, the greatest ones today, and I came to realize that a bit late, is not those handouts of prophecy. I have found that among people who have never had the word of God, they have never seen the inside of a Bible. were to get our means together today, it is to get King James Bibles. When you are going for mission, that is the only thing you need to go. Don't even waste time with great controversy. Great controversy is higher education. These are babies. They have not even learned to drink milk. And you know, I came to realize because our church, we always used to go out in the streets of Nairobi and we are handing out great controversy, great controversy. And these people in the Sunday church don't carry Bibles to their church. It is the pastor who has a Bible, so they have never, they don't even know where Romans is or where Psalms is. They don't, they have never seen. And then we give them a book that is referring to that verse, and they don't have a Bible at home. It's out. And then we come and say, today we handed out 300 books. The greatest need when we are out there for missions is Bibles. And you teach them how to read the Bible for themselves. This is what led to the Reformation. So our means, the money that we have, God needs them to get Bibles. And especially get to translate the King James Bible into Swahili and to the Latin. Because the Swahili Bible is corrupted. I tried to teach Bible study in Swahili. It was frustrating. It is worse than NIV. The words, the Swahili words are not the correct ones. I read the English and we read the Swahili and I ask the congregation, is that the right translation? They said, no, that is not the correct translation. And most things are not foolish to translate the Swahili Bible. It's a Catholic. So we have a big need to get a Swahili translation that is correct. And the same applies to all the vernacular languages in Kenya. They are all corrupted. And so people, you can't teach people the sanctuary. You can't teach people the state of the dead. A lot of those verses are corrupted. God needs your means for his cause. When you're going to the country, you are dedicating your means for the cause of God. And it requires a change of mindset. It requires a heart change. The members of the church should individually hold themselves and all their possessions upon where? The altar. God needs your means, your energy, your skill. All those should be used for the service of God. I could not sleep past 2 o'clock this morning. During the night season, I was in council. Listen, I was pleading with some families to avail themselves of God's appointed means and get away from the cities to save their children. Some were loitering, making no determined efforts. I am the vine and you are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me, ye can do nothing. What shall we then say to this thing? If God be for us, who can be against us? For every house is builded by some man, but he that builds all things is God. Okay? I was cited the case of Abraham. God said to him, take now thy son, thine only son Isaac, whom thou lovest, and get thee into the land of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering upon one of the mountains, which I will tell of thee. Abraham obeyed God, and it was counted for him righteous. That is the faith, my friends. The faith was shown by his obedience to what God said. Okay? He did not consult his feelings, but with a noble faith and confidence in God, he prepared for the journey. With a heart rent with anguish, he beheld the proud and loving mother gazing with fond affection upon the son of promise. But he led that loved son away. Abraham suffered. Yet he did not let his will rise in rebellion against the will of God. Duty, stern duty, controlled him. He dared not consult his feelings or yield to them for one moment. His only son walked by the side of the stern, loving, suffering father, talking engagedly, uttering over and over the fond name of the father, and then inquiring, "Are you discussing Christ?" Right? Curse ye Meroth, say the angel of the Lord. Curse ye bitterly the inhabitants thereof, because they came not to don't come to the help of the Lord, we shall be cursed. God needs your help. And when you don't come to help him, then you will be cursed with curse. But thou, Israel, art my servant, Jacob, whom have I chosen, the seed of Abraham, my friend. For I, the Lord thy God, will hold thy right hand, saying unto thee, fear not, I will help thee. When we help the Lord, he will do what? He will help us. Parents can secure small homes in the country with land for cultivation, where they can have orchards and where they can raise vegetables and small fruits. So there is a place of flesh meat, which is so corrupting to the life blood coursing through the veins. On such places, the children will not be surrounded with the corrupting influences of the city life. God will help his people to find such homes outside the city. That is the prophet. The word of God has said it, the prophet has said it. God will help his people. How? By the help of the Lord. Okay? I'm almost done. Let every man be wide awake for himself and try to save his family. Let him guard himself for the work. God will reveal from point to point what to do next. It varies for each individual. So don't ask for one formula. If you pray to God, he will reveal to you from point to point what to do next. Alright, some of the things to consider. How much land do you need? What's the nearest town? What is its population? How far away? How far is the nearest large cities? What is the population density of the county? There are some things we need to have an idea. How many growing seasons are there? How far the county maintained road? Does the county require building permits? I saw my friend, Ken, are you here? I saw your brother is building there and he has put, I believe he got a building permit to put up a structure. Okay, so you need to find out, you're going to put up a structure whether you need a permit, all right? Does the property have a clean title? Is surface water present on the property? Does fruit grow in the area? How close is the nearest neighbor? There's some things you need to find out when you're going to a place and you place the matter before God, okay? And these are some of the key pillars for country living. I'll discuss more about this tomorrow, but just as something to think about. The nobleman wanted to see the fulfillment of his prayer before he should leave. But he had to accept the word of Jesus that his request was heard and the blessing granted. This lesson we have to learn. Not because we see or feel that God hears us are we to believe. Okay? We are to trust in his promises. When we come to him in faith, every petition enters the heart of God. When we have asked for his blessing, we should believe that we receive and thank him that we have received. Then we are to go about our duties assured that the blessing will be realized when we need it most. When we have learned to do this, we shall know that our prayers are answered. God will do for us exceeding abundantly according to the riches of his glory and the working of his mighty power. If you have the prayer of faith and you trust God and you are right with him, he will answer your prayer and you will find yourself in the country. But you must take the step of faith. Like the Israelites put the stake towards the Red Sea and the sea parted. Without faith, we cannot do so. May God bless you.
Amen.
I'd like us to kneel down and pray. Faith that made the sun to stand still and the moon to stand still. Lord, may we have that faith of Joshua and the faith of Hezekiah. This is my prayer in Jesus' name.
Amen.